While you're finding your seat, if you'll join me in Psalm 13, it's my goal to linger there this morning and mine, hopefully, the riches of Christ from Psalm 13. If this is your first time with us, we believe that the power is in the Word, not in the personality, and so we give ourselves to God's Word because we believe God wrote a book, and that to hear the voice of God is to open the Word of God, and so very, very thankful for God's Word. Personally, I've been, as I shared last week, in Psalm 1 since January the 1st, and it's been my practice almost every day just to try to linger there. And then as we were praying and planning what would be good for this summer, knowing that there's a lot of people traveling in and out, we felt that it would be hopefully spiritually fruitful to spend some time in selective psalms. And so last week we began with Psalm 1. If you're interested in that, you can go back and grab that online. But I'm thankful that you're in the room because there's power when we open God's Word together and study it together rather than just digital means. But nonetheless, Psalm 13, I hope this morning will be encouraging to you, but it is a minor note. One of the things about the Psalms is that you find so many different emotions in the book of Psalms that we can relate to. I shared with you last week that it's a very personal book, the Psalter, the prayer book of the church, the song book of Israel, that there's so many different things. There's lament, there's deep sorrow, there are mountaintop experiences of great praise and jubilation, and there's so many different emotions. There's valleys of weakness, and there's triumph. There are prayers of what's called imprecatory prayers, where it seems as if justice is on the tip of the writer's pen, and there's so many different things. But this psalm particularly, I think, is both instructive and helpful because the way I would summarize it, I've tried to capture it in the title for us this morning, is real despair and real help. Real despair and real help. And as I've been working through this psalm this week, my aim, which finally came to me on Friday, I would love to say that I'm done on Thursdays, but that doesn't happen. Thinking about pastoral ministry, thinking about the privilege to, in humility, to preach for you, and is that the simple aim from this psalm this morning, if you want to write it down, it may be helpful in your own discipleship, is to help you, and even sometimes me, okay, overcome despair and prepare us for seasons of discouragement, even depression. Now, when I say that, you'll find quickly when we read this psalm that that's where that aim actually comes from, that it's not something that I'm trying to impose on the text, but actually something that emerges from the text, and you find it all over the psalm. As a matter of fact, this week I found myself in Psalm 1, Psalm 13, Psalm 42, where the psalmist would say in Psalm 42, "Why is your soul downcast, O my soul?" And then even in Psalm 88, I would just challenge you this afternoon, go home and read Psalm 88. Take 5 minutes, read through that psalm, and just see the valley of despair that the psalmist is walking through, even in Psalm 88. But Psalm 13, the beginning of this, really shows us what many of us know that sadly sometimes, often within the life of the church, sometimes few admit. And that is that we do have to deal with great despair. That even the Christian experience is sometimes full of deep sorrow. And there is this sad reality sometimes even in ministry and even in the West of this evangelical triumphantism that never deals with this subject. And we want to be good Bible students and we want to be good realists this morning. And so let's read the first part of Psalm 13, but then see the conclusion of where real help, I hope, comes from, or we see it emerge. So verse 1, notice how the psalmist begins. "How long, O Lord, will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me? How long must I take counsel in my soul and have sorrow in my heart all the day? How long shall my enemy be exalted over me? Consider and answer me, O Lord my God. Light up my eyes, lest I sleep the sleep of death. Lest I sleep the sleep of death. Lest my enemies say, I have prevailed over him. Lest my foes rejoice because I am shaken." The psalmist is very real. He's very honest. Here you have David. I mean, think about this for just a moment. We don't know exactly the context here, but you have David who slew Goliath, who in some considerations is the man after God's own heart, and yet he begins this psalm in the dungeon of despair. I find this very helpful because he's very honest. He's not like most today, but he actually admits that there is a season in his life that's revealed in this psalm of deep sorrow, so much so that did you catch the image? Did you see the image? Don't miss it. He notes in verse 3, as he begs God, consider and answer me, O Lord my God. Light up my eyes, lest I sleep the sleep of death. That's pretty profound, isn't it? How honest. That unless something happens, it's as if this despair has a chokehold on his life, and it's almost as if time's running out. You see, a couple of things, a couple of observations that I think are important before we look at his condition, and that is simply two things quickly. One, despair and depression are very real. Even some of the best among us, even in the life of the church, have experienced this. This is why I would encourage you to read Christian biographies. Read a little bit more widely, even know people in your own church a little bit better, right? Some of those that are giants that we revel in their deeds for Christ, we forget that they suffered greatly. David is one of the primary biblical examples of one who was in despair often. I think about William Cowper, who is a great hymn writer, who suffered deeply in regards to deep sorrow, a melancholy state that sometimes they couldn't understand why he was so discouraged. Even Charles Spurgeon, the great one that we quote often, we think about God's work through the Metropolitan Tabernacle and how many that were reached under that ministry, and yet Spurgeon would even say there would be mornings that he would have to tape scripture above his bed, and he would have to use the scripture above his bed to get out of bed because he was so sorrowful. And we go through life and we forget that deep discouragement and depression can actually be a reality. I recommend to you, Dr. Martin Lloyd-Jones wrote a book called Spiritual Depression, Its Causes and Cure. He wrote this, page 15, in other words, he says, as I understand the biblical teaching about this matter, talking about spiritual depression, there is nothing which is quite so important as that we should, without delay and as quickly as possible, get to know ourselves. For the fact of the matter is that though we are all Christians together, obviously writing to believers here, we are all very different, and the problems and the difficulties, the perplexities and trials that we are likely to meet are in large measure determined by the difference of our temperament and type. We are all in the same fight, of course, as we share the same common salvation. There is nothing more futile when dealing with this condition than to act on the assumption that all Christians are identical in every respect. They are not, and they are not even meant to be. We have to admit that from Psalm 13, what quickly emerges is that even the great writer David himself suffered greatly. There's something also that's an important observation in this psalm, and Psalm 13, and I want you to just think for a minute before we look at specifically at the condition. One of the most, I think, helpful things about an observation from this psalm that's important is that there is no stated cause. If you read these verses, even Psalm 88, there is no cause that is given in the text to why David is so downcast. Now, I would suggest to you that that is extremely important for us because I know many of you. I know my own background and I know some of your backgrounds. And what we like to do when we're dealing with this subject of deep depression or discouragement is we want to get to the reason, which is important. But I've been around really good, well-meaning Christians who want to diagnose the problem and dismiss the fruit of the problem. And there is, being tethered to this text, to my good, strong, conservative brothers, no reason given. There is no stated reason. There is only a stated cause. And so I would make a suggestion for all of us to be very sympathetic, patient, and even caring when we come to situations like this. You see, many of us have heard that we need a theology for suffering. How many of you have heard that before? And we need a theology for suffering. And yet we've often tied that theology of suffering to acts of faith that are heroic, like going to hard places in the world. And we teach that rightly, that we need a theology for suffering, for acts of faith. But we also need a theology of despair where we cannot put our finger on the why. And I think if we're thoughtful about this, this triumphant idea that some of us carry that dismisses despair as weakness or even sometimes sinfulness can actually do damage to the soul and conscience of our brothers and sisters. We need the healing balm of the gospel of grace, and we need to be able to dispense that to those who are struggling. How many of us, if we were to be honest, specifically believers in the room who've traveled a few miles, who have gone through this journey, you could identify with David and say, "How long, O Lord? How long? How long?" Notice four quick things about his condition. First of all, it's prolonged. How long, O Lord? It's repeated at the beginning of this psalm at least three times, right? How long? How long? How long? One of the things that we see about this condition is it's represented in this repeating truth that it's an enduring anguish. It's not just a bad day, right? It's not just a sort of a blip on the screen. It's actually a prolonged condition. There's enduring anguish here. It seems as if the darkness will never end. So we see quickly that it's prolonged. Secondly, we see it's pronounced. Notice in verse 1, notice the emotion here. How long, O Lord? Notice, will you forget me forever? Will you forget me forever? And it actually extends beyond his feeling of abandonment to even being defeated. He says, will you hide your face from me? How long must I take counsel in my soul, have sorrow in my heart? And then how long shall my enemy be exalted over me? It's pronounced in the sense that the psalmist, that David feels not only forgotten, but he feels forsaken. That the presence of God seems to be removed from him. And we see that it's painful. So it's prolonged, it's pronounced, it's painful. Notice he says, sorrow in my heart. Sorrow in my heart. This is not just some diagnosis in the counselor's office or room. But David is saying that there is real sorrow here. There's real pain. And then the last thing that we see is that he feels powerless. Notice how long at the end of verse 2 shall my enemies be exalted over me? I mean, his condition's pretty dire, isn't it? It's pretty honest. But it reminds us that sometimes this can even be our experience. Now, we know that there's different degrees of this discouragement, despair, depression. We understand that. But we have to acknowledge that this psalm and other psalms teach us that this can be a reality. So what do we do? Right? What do we do? What, if this is true, maybe this is you. I don't know all of, I don't know every situation that's in the room. But when you're there, when you can identify with the psalmist, what do you do? This is why this psalmist is so helpful. This psalm is so beautiful. It gives us help. It only doesn't just teach us that there's real despair. It gives us real help. How many of you enjoy being helped along the way, right? And so I like being helped. And so notice how this psalm turns, starting in verse 3. Here's where the help comes in. Consider and answer me, O Lord my God. Light up my eyes, lest I sleep the sleep of death, lest my enemies say I have prevailed over him, lest my foes rejoice because I am forsaken. But I have, notice verse 5, but I have trusted in your steadfast love. Notice the tense. I have trusted in your steadfast love. Don't miss this. My heart shall rejoice in your salvation, and I will sing to the Lord because he has dealt bountifully with me. There's so much help here, right? So much grace. So what do you do? What do we do? Where do we turn when the waves of sorrow seem like they will never stop crashing in on our soul? What do we do? First of all, I would suggest to you, we follow suit and we plead with God to lift the clouds. It's amazing to me that instead of running from the Lord and being even bitter towards the Lord, what does David do? What does he teach us? Instead of becoming bitter or angry and stiff-arming God, he pleads with the only sovereign who can open his eyes and come to his aid. Do you notice that? Where does David go? He consistently pleads to the Father to open his eyes. He realizes that in the depth of his despair, there is no better answer than to turn his focus to God who can. And it's the same for us. That doesn't mean that there aren't means of God's grace that can help us, okay? That doesn't mean that. But what I think we have to come to terms with and have to see is David goes straight to the only answer, and he pleads with the Father. He does not give up on the spiritual discipline of prayer. He goes to the Father, and he recognizes that God is the only sovereign who can turn the lights back on. As he's in the dungeon of despair, he keeps praying. He keeps praying. How many of you remember Acts 17, Paul and Silas? Do you remember Acts 17? Guess what? They are in prison for sharing Jesus. And Paul has already been run out of town. He's already been beaten. He's already been threatened. And yet in Acts 17, he and Silas end up in prison for loving and sharing Jesus. And guess what they do at midnight? They sing. They praise God. They turn their attention to God. They do not give up on their walk with the Lord, even in the midst of their sorrow. And neither should we. So we must plead with God to lift the clouds. If there's one thing that I can encourage you as a believer, if you're in the valley of sorrow, do not neglect, well, there's all kinds of things, but do not neglect communion with Christ. Do not neglect pleading with him to turn the lights on. So we must plead to God to lift the clouds. Secondly, we also see something that's important here is that we have to preach to ourselves. I told someone this week, I'm going to give you permission to preach a sermon to yourself, right? We see this, right? Preach to yourself. It's amazing. Notice what's happening here. There's almost this dialogue, both of prayer to the Lord, and then it's as if David turns on his own soul and preaches to himself. When we're in sorrow, and using Lloyd Jones again, Lloyd Jones said that we are too good at listening to ourselves and not preaching to ourselves. When you're in the thick or in the cloud of despair, what happens is we allow our emotions to sort of rule us rather than taking the objective truth of God's character and who he is and what he's done and clinging to that. I like what Begg said about this, that we need to work to bring our emotions underneath the jurisdiction of God's character. And that's what he does here. We need to stop listening to ourselves, friends, and we need to start preaching the gospel to ourselves. You need to preach really Christ-exalting, Bible-saturated, Spirit-empowered messages to your soul when you're discouraged. Can I get an amen? Amen. When you feel abandoned, you need to take the truth of God's word. You need to open it, you need to read it, and you need to preach it. You need to stand up in the face of your sorrow, right? You need to stand up in the face of your sorrow, and you need to declare the greatness of God. You need to declare the finished work of Jesus. You need to declare that Jesus rose from the dead. You need to declare that the Spirit has come and attends to his word. You need to declare that in Christ there is nothing that can defeat us. And you need to preach that to your soul every day. You need to preach really good messages to your soul. And we need to bring our emotions under the jurisdiction of God's character. Notice verse 5. But I have trusted in what? Don't miss the what. In your steadfast love. Where does he go? What's the first point of his message to himself? It is the covenant-keeping loyal love of the Father. And he declares to himself that nothing removes his love from me. That God is faithful in his love towards us. Secondly, notice another part of his character. Notice, my heart shall what? Rejoice in your salvation. These two things that we would rejoice in. So what we need to do quickly is that we need to tell ourselves about our past trust in the steadfast love of God. You could think of it this way. You and I need to be really good at recalling God's love to us in the history of our life. You need to sit down with the history of your life and you need to recount God's faithful love to you. Everyone in this room When you think about this, God has been faithful to some degree or another. And one of the things that can be good for your soul and my soul in the valley of sorrow is to recall God's love to me. The practical love of the Father that when I was in sorrow and felt abandoned, God sent a guy by the name of Joe Ryan to care for me and pray for me. That when I was in the valley of despair, God gave me a new song, He Shall Hold Me Fast, and I just put it on repeat. That was God's love to me. That when I have been in deep need, the Father has provided every time. And when I look back on that, it is God's love shouting to me. And I need to preach that to my heart when I feel sorrow and despair. Recall God's love and then rejoice in His salvation. We as God's people should be the type of people who are full of joy, not because of what we do, but because of what He's done. That the psalmist says here, instead of sitting down with despair, right? Instead of sitting down with, you know, what I haven't done or what I wish I would have done or what someone did to me, I sit down and I rejoice in God's salvation. And I think about Christ became man so that He would be my substitute and He would represent me before the Father. I think about that Christ became a curse hanging on a tree so that I could be forgiven and accepted by the Father. I think about Christ as my ransom so that I could be set free from the prison of sorrow. I think about Christ, my great high priest, serving as my advocate before the throne of God. I think about Christ, my great shepherd, who leads me into still waters and green pastures, who cares for my soul, who guides me. What I need on a bad day, I don't need a spiritual fix. I need to turn my attention to the salvation that only Jesus Christ offers. And my soul needs to revel in the fact that Jesus died for me. An undeserving sinner, adopted as a son into the kingdom of God by the work of Christ. I need to recount His salvation. And then what's the last thing that we learn when we're in valleys of despair that we should do? We should plead with God. We should preach to ourselves really good gospel-centered messages. And the last thing that we should do is we should sing of His grace. I'll be honest with you. I know Ryan wasn't here, but Victoria and just the team, when you think about Mary and the team here trying to lead us, it was great. I enjoyed it. But I was thinking, I know there's visitors here today, but I was like, I wonder if we're really singing. You see, both private, public, singing is a gift of God's grace. Notice what how he concludes this. I know we've got to hurry, but I will sing to the Lord because He has dealt bountifully with me. How many people in our fickle, anemic churches have given up on the discipline and the beauty and the glory of singing privately and singing together regularly? We treat corporate worship like it's an option. Well, let me suggest to you, dear friend, when I get together with you to sing of God's grace together, it is not an option for my soul. It is not an option. Because there can be days that I can come in here, and I know I have the privilege to open this, that I can feel bad just like you on certain days. But when I seek by God's grace to tune my heart to His grace and mercy, and I hear you sing of His wonder and His majesty, guess what begins to happen on that front row? You see, singing, when you miss it or give up on it, you stop turning your eyes to Christ, and very quickly you keep your eyes on yourself and on your circumstance. The psalmist says, in the middle of feeling like it's about to slip away, I will sing. Over 500 times in the Bible, singing is referred to. 50 of those are direct commands. Zephaniah, how many of you know that the Heavenly Father sings loudly over His children? Do you remember Jesus sang a hymn with the disciples? Do you remember that? And so may I suggest to you, you may not feel joy in your heart. You may be on the precipice of despair and you may feel really broken, can I suggest that you don't just need a good theology of worship, you need a good, healthy practice of worship. Too many people can today articulate a really good theology of worship. And they know that they've given up on worship. Notice how, why does he say sing? Because he has dealt bountifully with me. So friend, here's the truth. Don't turn away any longer. Look away from your sorrow and discouragements this morning and look towards Jesus. Look at his steadfast love towards you. Look at his saving work towards you and see how bountifully he has dealt with you. Stop feeling sorry for yourself and keep trusting him, keep rejoicing in him, and start singing to him. Notice, I will sing to the Lord because he has dealt bountifully with me. Will you pray with me? Father, thank you for your word this morning. We